Do you see my screen?
Yes.
Great. Today, together with Peter Popov, we will talk about translating some of interesting code constructs from Delphi to C++. The idea came from having to work on a huge Delphi database that was mainly developed by Peter Popov during long years. And when I joined that project, they have there are two versions for each of the programs, for Delphi and for C++. And I will be talking about the first half of the examples, and Peter Popov will be doing the next part. So the function write line in Delphi, it's an interesting function that takes arbitrary count of parameters and prints them either to the console or to the file or some open file. It's interesting in Delphi because you cannot normally have declaration of such kind of function because Delphi doesn't allow having arbitrary count of parameters, at least Delphi 7. So the example here is we can supply as parameters strings and some numbers, and it will print them to the console if they are just values which doesn't some plain values, and if the first parameter is open file, it will print them to a file. And that's one of the approaches to implementing such a function in C++ with a variadic function template which writes to the console. This thing here is the main recursive variadic template. So it takes value and the other values, the rest of the values, and what we do here is to output the value with cout and then to recursively call the same function but in C++ of course with the rest of the values, and at the bottom of that recursion is when we have no parameters, it would just print the new line, which is exactly what write line in Delphi does. And this is the way that we can call it in C++. It's exactly the same as in Delphi. The next slide is when we want to have that write line function to print on the some open file stream. The only difference here is that as a first argument, we should always use the output stream, and we output the value that comes after it to that output stream. And this is the way that we can use it. We open an output stream, this one here, and just exactly the same call as in Delphi, we can write line to that file. So I want to show them in a live editor. You still see what I'm presenting, right? I mean, you should now see the code in Delphi.
Yes, and we can.
Okay. And if we run it, we see that we have some text. This is the file. And in the console, we have, again, this text and some numbers. And in C++, this is the implementation of both of the variadic template functions. And here are the tests that show that they work. And if we start this function, this program, we can see that we have the same, almost the same text. The difference is because due to the fact that C++ treats 22 divided by 7 as being an integer. But everything else works fine. So having in mind that, we can accommodate that, for example, with float. Guys, sorry, I'm presenting. So here you can see that even we can, for example, have it right line to write on an open file. I'm not sure if I, yeah, here. So with this variadic template, we can also use it on a console, on an open file stream, and on a plain old file pointer from C. Okay, then I'll continue with nested functions in Delphi. They are available for many years. Something which is not allowed in C++ because you know that in C++ you are not allowed to have inner function in some other function. All the functions have to be at the upper level. So the nested function is in Delphi is declared within other function and it is scoped only to that function. For example, you cannot call the nested product here from an outer function. And the other interesting thing is that this function here, nested product, has access to all the variables that are defined before the definition of that function. So if we start that simple example here, it will produce that result. You can see here that we are calling a nested product by incrementing local var from 5 to 10. And because nested product has access to local var, it can compute that product here. You can see that it has access also to the parameter that's supplied to the outer procedure. And of course, in C++, we can achieve that functionality with lambdas. And to have access to all the variables that are defined before the inner function here, the lambda, we can capture the values, the variables with by reference. And that's the equivalent code that comes in C++. I can show it also in the online debuggers. This is the Delphi version. And this is the result that it produces. Again, to just remind you that I've pasted in the chat of that meeting the links so you can try it. And the other one is the C++ version. and it produces the same result. So going back to the presentation, something else that's interesting in Delphi is that we have something that's called a ranged array, and it has a starting address that's specified by the user. So for example, we can have an array of integers that is indexed from 22 to 33. And that's the way that we access the that array. And this is one of the ways to just hard code the starting and the ending indexes. The other way is to use the built-in functions low and high that take an array for argument and return the lower and the higher, the lowest and the highest index in that array. You can see here the output. So we are printing the elements from 22 to 33. And also you can see that the length of this array is 12. It's not, for example, 33 or something like this. And the size of that array is 48 bytes, because each integer in that setting occupies 4 bytes. So first I will present the way that the one would expect it to be used by C++, and then I will show the definition of a range array. A range array is something that's prepared to mimic the functionality of the range array that are built in Delphi. So we here declare an array that's a template, and we supply the starting index, the ending index, and the fact that it we want it to be from integers. And exactly the same way it is used by in the code. We also can reproduce the functionality of low and high for that array. And you can see here that first it outputs the absolutely same output, and also the lengths and the size of that array is exactly as in the Delphi. So we are not occupying more memory. And that's the short and, in my opinion, elegant implementation of range array. So it's a template class, and it takes integers as parameters that define the low and high indexes and the type name of the type of the elements. We can assert here with static assert that high is higher than low. Remember that high is the last one, not the one after the last one, like usually used in C++. We here try to be as close to Delphi code as possible. So what we do here is to store in a const expressions the low and high boundaries, and to compute the length. And what we do here is to overload to define the operator brackets, indexing operator, square brackets, which returns a reference to the element so we can read it and write it. And yep, I can show you how it works in Delphi and also in C++. So here we have some sorry, it reminds me that I have another slide here. a multi-dimensional range array, and the way it is used in Delphi, it's just by simply separating the dimensions with a comma. This is the way that in Delphi it's declared. And I think it's pretty reasonable the way that it can be used from C++. For example, here we are saying that we have a range array of range arrays, which are from for this dimension from 5 to 10 of integers, exactly like here. And here is, I think, very natural usage of that range array. And here I'll show you the Delphi version of this range arrays. You can see here the array being from 22 to 33 indexes, and the multi-dimensional array here. And also something which is interesting is to test the performance of the two kinds of range indexes, arrays, one in Delphi and one in C++. So if we start that program here, we can see the output that was shown previously in the slides, the length and the size being the same as in the slides. Some example of multidimensional array, some sum, which is taken from the test performance routine, and the time of execution being 3.2 seconds. So, range array in C++. This is the definition of the template, the template class. And here in the operator square brackets, the indexing operator, you can see that if we want, we can, for example, implement range checking. And I'll start it again so we can see the output. We can see here again the output from the slides with exactly the same length and size of arrays, and the same sum, and roughly double the time that the time execution is from Delphi. But we have something here that's that should be also considered. This is from the compilation with default optimization. It means with no optimization. So we can here add the optimization flag for Delphi, which is 04 for the most optimized version, and we can run it again. It wasn't applied because of done was not pressed, but time of execution in Delphi code dropped to 1.8 seconds. And we can see what happens with C++ code with the most of optimizations that we can get from the compiler. So you can see that this implementation is beating even the implementation that is in the Delphi code. Okay, so let's get back to our presentation. Try finally is a code construct from Delphi, which means which is used. So after a try block, we have a finally block that is executed. No matter if we have exception in the try block or not. For example, this is a construction that we don't have in C++ because, you know, there we only have the try catch construction that's of course also available in Delphi. But here we are interested in the try finally construction. In Delphi, normal production code in Delphi, you can see a lot of try finalies because it's usually related to manually cleaning resources. For example, if you examine this code here, we have an object to be cleaned, which is created, so some memory is allocated for it. Then we are trying to calculate some function which can throw an exception, taking a square root of a negative number. And no matter if that function runs or it just throws an exception, we want to free the object to be cleaned. And just to be sure what happened, we output cleanup and the value of the root. So here are three example invocations of that function. With number four, we see that we come here in the right to the right line statement, and it shows that we've done the cleanup and the root with its value. The same thing with number being 36. And if we supply minus one as a number, again, we go to the cleanup here and the root is not a number. So it shows that no calculations have happened here. Again, I will first show you the way that could be used from C++, and then I'll show you the definition of the finally block after that slide. So what we exploit here is that in C++ we have an automatic destructor call at the end of scope, and the destructor is called no matter if we have exception or not. This is a well-known way of using C++. So what we do here is that we have a finally block which is created of with lambda function that captures all the variables that are defined before that finally block. And the body of that lambda does the things that initially we had in the Delphi code, namely to delete the object to be cleaned, and to output that we have done the cleanup and to output the root. So you can see here that after exiting that scope, we should call that finally block. And that's the definition of the finally block. It's really simple. We have a function which we store when constructing the finally block, and then this function is called at the destruction of this block. So I can show that code in the online editor. This is this simple application. The only thing here is that we've we've done also the try catch block, which in Delphi is try except. The try finally function is the same one as shown in the slides. And here is the way that it throws an exception. In Delphi, it's called rising exception. So starting it will produce this output. We have with number 4 cleanup and root of 2, and with 36 again, and when called with number minus 1, we do the cleanup, which is shown that we have executed that line and of course the line before it. And the exception is propagated to the way that it's catched here. So we printed that got an exception message. Okay, and the way that it's handled from C++, you can see that short definition of the finally block with which is constructed with a function, and at its destruction, it just calls that function. We have again the square root function, which throws an exception when the number is negative, and exactly the same constructs here. So I can just run it. And we have exactly the same output as in Delphi. You can see here that the exception that was thrown when the number was minus 1 got catched here with got an exception. But you can also see that when we had an exception when calling that my square root function, we also did the cleanup. So we deleted that object to be clean. Of course, this is just an example how we can literally translate the try finally blocks from Delphi. Another more well accepted approach in C++ is to just have constructor destructors, so we can implement the resource acquisition initialization principle instead of relying on try finally mimics. Okay. And the last thing that I will present you is that construct from Delphi, which is, in my opinion, very elegant. Delphi has the ability to pass a method to an object to other functions, so this other function can use that method. Method and its related instance are passed and can be later used. This one method here, the only requirement is that it has the same signature. So if a method of a class, for example, is a procedure which means void in C++, and it takes an integer as an argument, it doesn't matter if it's from one class on or another. So the beautiful thing here is that we can pass that method no matter of what class hierarchy is that class, as long as we have that procedure signature or function signature the same. And here is an example what we can do with that past method. We can of course invoke it with some parameters. And yeah, any method from any class can be used. And here is an example for that. For example, for that do something with method function, we can use a procedure, which is a plain procedure here. And we can also pass as an argument a virtual function that can be even overloaded, overridden from some other derived classes. Okay. And I can show you the way that it works in Delphi before proceeding to the C++ implementation. So we have this type of parameter that we can pass. This is an object procedure, which is procedure of object. And here we have the do something with method, with takes an argument that passed method and integer. And what it does is to call that method three times. And we have tests which test the base class, calling the plain procedure and then the virtual procedure. Then we are testing also the past method with you can see here that we have X created as a derived class, but stored in a base class, which is a usual construction in also in C++ and in Delphi. And here we expect that the virtual procedure is the one that the derived class provides. And we also have here an unrelated class that's outside of this hierarchy. And we just created, and we are just supplying that method to do something with method function. So this is an illustration of that, that do something with method can be really flexible. We can supply whatever method of class we want, as long as it it's the same signature. So in the base class, the same virtual some virtual procedure just outputs its name and some internal variables of that class. And in the derived class, it outputs its name. So if I start it, we can see here that even if the procedure is to a object that's from the base class, because the actual object is from the derived class, you can see here that the proper method is called. Okay, quite a complex example, but you can play with it if you want in the online debugger. You just have to click on the link. Okay, and the way that it should be used from C++, I just show you here a comparison between them. You can see here that it's almost one-to-one comparison between them. We have a type of object procedure, which is a function, just a function. We don't say anything about being a method or something like this. And what we do with that type, with that parameter, is to just call it exactly the same way as in the Delphi code. And here is the usage. Again, I will show you first the usage so you can see that it's almost one-to-one in Delphi. And then I'll show you how it can be accomplished with some C++ code. For example, for my class, we have again the plain procedure and the virtual procedure, and testing the class is, and the only difference here is that we should use that pass method macro to wrap up the variable and the method that should be used on that variable. Instead of just using the natural construction in Delphi, we use in C++ that macro. And that's the implementation of pass method. It requires C++ 20. Sorry. And it uses that bind front standard library function. And it's quite nested, but if we, it's not so complex, it's fairly simple. Starting from method, this is the argument of the one of the arguments of the macro. So we want to wrap up this method and the object in a callable that later can be called with supplying other arguments to that. And all of the rest is just to have that object to have the class of the objects, so we can take the proper address of that function, and we are stripping the reference and pointer from the type of the object, so this allows us to call the to pass method not only with a pointer but also with a reference or the variable itself. Okay, so I'll show it how it works in C++. So this is the only thing that we need to have in C++. The definition of that macro, and all of the rest is exactly as in Delphi. For example, I can show you the derived class, and it again outputs the derived class name of the procedure. And I can start it. You can see here that this is exactly the same as in the Delphi code, and the derived procedure is called. So this is something being equivalent to that C++ to that Delphi code, and yep, for the main reason for the desire to have them being so close to each other is, for example, if one decides to implement a automatic translator from Delphi code to C++ code. Okay, and that's all from my side, and I'll give the word to Peter. Peter, please go ahead.
Okay, so let me share my screen. So I'll cover the remaining three topics, which are constructors, destructors, meta classes, and finally a simple example on namespace initialization. So classes in Delphi are very similar to Java. Okay, so here we are. So classes to in Delphi are very similar to Java. In fact, this was a change in the language around 95, about the same time that Java appeared. Previously, the objects that were being used in Turbo Pascal used to be similar to the objects in C++, in a sense that you could have them on the heap, you could have them on the stack. And unfortunately, back then, there were a few annoying omissions, which were basically default constructors and copy constructors. So for whatever reasons, they redesigned, the classes were redesigned. And what appeared was something very similar to Java. So you have classes are implicit references. Objects are always created on the heap. And unfortunately, or fortunately, depends on the viewpoint, unlike Java, you need to explicitly destroy whatever you have created. Delphi is a single inheritance language. And again, depending on the viewpoint, everything that you define is implicitly derived from a base object. And there are several reasons for that. But first, we discuss constructors and destructors. So unlike C++, constructors are named as regular functions, and you can name them any way you want. The base constructor, if you are in the constructor of a derived class, the base constructor is not explicitly called. So if you want to call it, you need to do this explicitly. Constructors can be virtual functions. And the reason is, there are two reasons why they can be virtual functions. One is you can actually call a constructor as a regular void function on an already existing class reference. And the second reason you can have virtual constructors is you can use a concept of metaclasses, where you can actually create object with an which you do not know what the actual class is at compile time. For example, if you have a string representation of an object, you can convert this to a class reference and then construct it using a virtual constructor. But this is the second example I'll give. However, these are mostly semantics. You can go around them in various ways. The main difference between Delphi and C++ is the way the virtual method table is initialized and deinitialized. In Delphi and in Java, the virtual method table of the actual class that you have at runtime is populated before the first constructor is ever called. And it is destroyed after any destructors, all the destructors that you want executed have finished. The side kick of this thing is that you can call virtual functions in constructors. So once you enter the virtual, once you enter a constructor, you already have the VMT populated. So if you execute a virtual functions, it is going to get the correct pointer to the actual method at runtime. In C++, the VMT is initialized at the level of the current constructor. So if you have several classes, one derived from the other, whenever you enter the base constructor, you have the VMT initialized for that particular class. When you go to the constructor of a derived class, you keep on populating the VMT until you finally done with the actual runtime implementation of your class. So here is an example of how things work in Delphi. Implicitly, even if you create a class which inherits nothing, implicitly it is going to create, it is implicitly going to inherit from a base class, which has certain functionality. The default constructor is a function called void function called create. So in this example, I have created a constructor which is not the default constructor. Or, I mean, again, the concept of default constructor is not one-to-one compared to C++, but here I have named the constructor differently. I have defined a virtual function, and I have a derived class with the same constructor and another virtual function. So, for example, this is the base class implementation. You just write whatever class you're in, and you call this virtual function, which just states its name and the class it belongs to. Now, in the derived class, the first key difference is that unless you explicitly use the inherited keyword, you're not going to have the base constructor code. So if you are in the constructor of this class, then you're not going to call this automatically. If you are here, the only way you're going to have this constructor called automatically is if you use this keyword. The other difficulty in translating code that this creates is that actually you can put this keyword anywhere you want. For example, you can first execute this statement, then you can have the inherited keyword which is going to transfer control to this function, and then you execute this one. So generally, with classes, it is really on a case-to-case basis how you translate them, and it is not easy to translate. Here is this example program. So you create a pointer. So this is an object variable, but in reality, this is a reference to a class pointer in C++. So in C++, this would look like that. If you create a base class and you destroy it using the default constructor, this is not going to be called at all. Neither of these guys are going to be called. If you instead create it with this constructor, what is going to happen is this: you're going to enter this constructor. You will, at this point, before entering it, the VMT is populated. So then you execute this statement, and then you pull up the correct pointer from the VMT. And in this class, because you are initializing a base class, you're going to execute this function. Now, in this guy, you're initializing a derived class. You're creating a derived class. So in this example here, you're going to go to this constructor. This keyword is going to move you here. You're going to pull up the correct VMT for derived class, which is going to execute this part. Then the base constructor will finish. Control will go back to the derived class constructor. You'll execute this statement, and then you're going to call again the same foo, which is the derived class implementation. So here is the example online. So here you're creating the base class using the default constructor, which does nothing. So there is nothing here. Then you're creating a base class using the newly supplied constructor. As you can see, it goes to the constructor. It says that which constructor you're executing, and it is executing base class foo. Now the next example is here. So you create a derived class. So when you create a derived class, it first comes here, it calls inherited, which transfer control to this guy. it says that we are in the base class constructor. It pulls up the VMT from the actual runtime class, which is derived class, and executes foo for the derived class. Then this guy finishes. Control goes back to the derived class constructor. You say that you are now in the derived class, which is this statement. And finally, it pulls up the same VMT, which is the derived class foo. So generally, there is no simple recipe how to translate constructors and destructors. Destructor behavior is similar. One thing is general advice for C++ code is not to use virtual methods in constructors. Unfortunately, in Delphi code, this is very common practice. So the only way you can actually get around this in a serial way when you translate code is to do your initialization in a separate virtual function, separate from the constructor. This is the only way you can systematically translate Delphi code to C++ with respect to constructors and destructors. So unlike Delphi and C++, the same example will produce a different result. So here you have exactly the same hierarchy. You have a constructor, destructor, derived constructor, default constructor, derived destructor, and the same example when you create a derived class dynamically. You first go to the base constructor, you call the base foo because your VMT is populated up to the level of the base constructor. Then you go to the derived class, you populate the VMT. Now for the derived class, you execute the derived foo and so forth. The structure is reverse. But in Delphi, this would have been the derived class. So the other thing which really complicates stuff in Delphi is that you can put this wherever you want. So in general, constructors in Delphi act as regular functions on a class type. So for example, I can put this guy here. And the order in which the constructors will be called will change. So for example, now you're going to execute this guy. You're executing derived class constructor. You're pulling up the VMT pointer for a derived class, which is derived class foo. Then you are going to the inherited base constructor. You're in the base constructor. You're getting the VMT and correct one for a derived class, and you're executing again derived foo. So essentially, the only way you can mimic this thing is if all constructor destructor statements in Delphi you make as regular functions, virtual functions in C++, and you don't attempt to translate them as constructors and destructors, unless you have a simple case where you always call the inherited constructor as a first statement in your base, in your derived class. So unless you're in this situation, which is not necessarily the case, you don't call virtual functions, which is again not necessarily the case, you have a problem with constructors and destructors. So you have to use regular functions. The next concept in Delphi, which is difficult to directly translate in C++, is metaclasses. So what a metaclass is basically this. Any object that you create, if it has virtual functions, it has a virtual method table. So in Delphi, the virtual method table is typified. In other words, it is there is a separate compiler type which refers to the virtual method table of a particular object, a particular class. So what you do is you take the class type and you create a type which is the type of the class. Delphi in general supports very extensive runtime type information, and part of it is embedded in the base object that everyone inherits from. So the way you create this is if you have an object with, if you have an object with object of some class, and this is a regular object, then the type of this object is another type denoted here, my object class, for which purpose you use the construct class of my original class. You cannot create class of this guy, so this works only once. What this gives you are two things. The first thing is you get some equivalent of static class methods in C++. And what the type ID operator in C++ hides, Delphi exposes to an extreme. So typical usage of meta classes in Delphi is to create instances of objects which are unknown at compile time. For example, if you receive on a stream the name of a class, this allows you to create an instance of this particular class relatively easily. It also allows you to copy a particular class which is dynamically allocated at runtime. So you have a pointer to a base class. It is initialized with some derived class. If you want to copy this actual runtime class, you can use it. And you can use it also to change memory allocation behavior. So before I go into specific examples, let me show you how any object on Delphi looks like. So it has a default virtual destructor. It has a default constructor create, which is not very visible here, and it has a virtual destructor. Now, for example, this function new instance, denoting a method as a class function, adding class before a method, is the same. It's similar to declaring a static method. So this method does not need an object reference to work. However, implicitly, what is going to be passed as the this, so this guy, so in C++, this would be a simple, this actually returns a, what is omitted here from this table is the return types, but this will be a simple function in C++ without parameters. In Delphi, you're still going to get a this pointer, but the this pointer is not going to be the reference. It is going to be a pointer to the virtual method table of the actual class that you're working with. So what this guy actually does is it allocates the required space for the class at runtime. This guy initializes the instance before it is passed to the first constructor. And this function, for example, this guy returns the virtual method table of the actual class. And what is actually the elegant thing is that the virtual method table is typified as a separate type. This is an interesting function. It returns the name of the actual class. So if you call it on a class variable, it is going to return the name of the class. If you run it on a object instance, what will happen is the VMT for this object instance will get pulled and it will be passed to this function, which will again return the class name of the class. So how is this thing being used? So here I have an object, I have a class I have created. I have a void function which operates on the class variable, not on the not on the object reference. So the way this function is actually represented by the compiler is like that. So this is a void function which takes a this pointer, and this pointer, however, is a pointer. So what this guy is a pointer to the virtual method table. Here you define the class, the meta class. So you say class of this class, and this, in for all practical purposes, this is a pointer to the virtual method table. It is completely opaque. You don't have access to the actual VMT. However, you can call functions, which you can call static methods of this class, and they can be virtual. So there are two typical uses shown here. So I have two references to the base object. I have the VMT pointer and I have some string. This is a library function that allows you to store this derived object in some list, and later on you can use it to create it from a string. But before that, you can use the class type, call the static function, and you're going to get the name of the class. You can instantiate an object from derived class, assign it to a pointer to the base object. Then on this variable, which at, on this line, you only seeing a reference to the base object, you can call the class type function, which is going to get the VMT pointer as this type. And you can store it as a type. Now, when you call create on this guy, you're actually going to create an object, you're not going to create my object, you're going to create a derived object. So this construct here allows you to dynamically copy object reference that you do not know what it is. The second example, the second use case is if you want to serialize objects. Because every object in Delphi supports this static function, class name, which basically prints the name of the class, you can register it in some global list. And then this function will actually return the VMT. You typecast it to the base class reference. And then you can create it, which is going to create the derived object. So here is the example. Again, let's focus on the final part. So we start from the beginning. Here we type the class name of derived class, which is derived object. Here we create a derived object and assign it to a base class reference. Then we pull the class reference and we call create. The create constructor So we first call the function A. A is going to type the class, print the class name, and it is going to print the VMT pointer as an integer. So the first execution here prints derived object and the VMT pointer. Now, the second one, which is B, so we call B twice. It again calls the derived object, and so basically this construct here is going to copy a derived class when you have a reference to a base class. The last example is how you serialize a class. So this guy will return this guy is going to return the correct VMT, and then you assign it to a variable related to this base hierarchy, and when you create it, you actually create a derived object. Now what I'm going to show here is how to translate this particular functionality, serializing object, in C++. So you have the same base object, which has a single function which types what it is. You have a derived object with the same virtual function overridden, which types where we are. And we have this function which prints the info of the reference to a class that you get. So this is the key thing. We create a map which maps a string to a pointer to a class constructor. So unfortunately, type ID, even though it also works in a similar way, it provides very limited functionality. So what you cannot do is you cannot, for example, type new type ID and then some pointer. This is not going to work. However, you can get use type ID to get the name and store it in a list. Whenever you store it, you also store a pointer to a constructor. GCC, in particular in GCC, the actual name of this derived object is decorated with 13, which is most likely the number of symbols in the actual derived class. So the way you do it is you register your objects. So here you have registered all three objects, the base object, the derived object, and the third level object. You want to create the second level object from string. In reality, you have to be very mindful what your compiler is, but if you are using GCC, if this is your name, you have to prepend it with the number of symbols in the name. And then what this guy does, it finds the map corresponding to this name. It is a constructor, calls the constructors, and assigns it to the variable. So as you can see here, calling who am I gives you the derived object. So this is how it is done in C++. But again, there is no general way in which you can implement metaclasses. You have to copy functionality wherever it is used. So if you want to copy something else, in Delphi, and we've done that, we have provided a different way for allocating and deallocating objects. For example, if you have multiple objects of the same time, you would write a separate memory manager, you would override new instance, and you would use your own memory manager to, for example, allocate several thousand instances at the same time rather than using individual malocs. In C++, the way to do that would be to override the new operator. So you cannot, for example, if in some code somebody has decided to change the default behavior of new instance and free instance, this guy and this guy, then you cannot do it via type ID operators. You have to re-implement new and delete. So the final example I want to show, it's a simple one. Since very long time ago, actually, for some reason it returns me to the beginning of the presentation. So since very long time ago, original Turbo Pascal and then later on Delphi had the concept of structured namespaces. So any code you put, it's called unit. Any code you put in a unit has visibility within that file. You have the using namespace in C++ would actually be the way include files are used in Delphi. So you would use namespaces called units, and you would not have to do physically include files in another file. One feature which usually happens in production code is you have some global variables local to a unit or to a namespace, which needs to be initialized and deinitialized. In Delphi, this is done using these two keywords. So in the end of your file, you can put an initialization section where you do whatever you want with global variables. And then you have a finalization section where you free any resources that you have allocated here. This is done automatically by the compiler. It is a nice feature. Its translation to C++ is trivial. You declare a namespace, you create a class, which would be, for example, your global variables, and you use the fact that the constructor and the destructor will be called. So you define a variable of this class, and you use the fact that the constructor and destructor will be called at the start of the program and termination of the program, respectively. This is the last slide I have, so I'll go to the examples. This is the example in Delphi. So this is your namespace. This is the main file. The main file uses the namespace. This is the equivalent thing in C++ is include. The nice thing is that you're restricted to where you can include things. You can only include things in two particular places. So in the beginning of the main file, you can only include it in one place, which eliminates the fact that in C you can include files wherever you want, which can lead to chaos. And in one namespace, you can use other namespaces only in two places, the beginning of the public section and the beginning of the private section. So this is what happens. Your program is initialized. All unit initializations are called in the order in which they appear. Here, one. Then you execute the main function, which is this guy here. And then they initialize the units in the reverse order in which they were initialized. You achieve the same effect in C++ by defining this class. You can make it private, and then a single variable which holds your global variables initializes them and deinitializes them in the constructor and destructor. So with this, we end our presentation. And